Good afternoon, everyone. This is 287, and to those who are keeping the Sabbath today, I hope you're having a happy and blessed Sabbath. Now, I'm going to spend a few minutes today speaking on this particular subject. I had an interesting discussion with a coworker, and it brought back a previous discussion that I had about this topic of giants, or better yet, angels procreating with men or women on earth to create a giant race. This comes out of Genesis chapter 6, and there's several reasons why people believe this to be true, but I'm going to go over those first four verses, and I'm also going to read something that was written in 1870 out of the Spirit of Prophecy, which speaks about some things we should understand. One thing, keep in mind, if you're not studying scripture, and if you don't study historical documents and books, and I'm talking old books, I'm not talking about stuff that was recently written in the 20th century. If you're not studying these things, you're listening to others primarily based on what they say and stuff you're reading on Wikipedia or whatever. Studying true history is important. A lot of this stuff was written without malice or without ulterior motive. Remember, historical documents and books used to just be written in the form of passing information on. You can't trust a whole lot of what's written today because there are too many agendas behind this stuff that's put into books. Definitely media, television, and all these other social types of communicating. There are too many agendas, and primarily most of that falls behind money and fame and popularity. So you have to study history. But as always, the most important piece of history is the Holy Scriptures. Now, I'm going to tell you something else about the Holy Scriptures. When you're trying to read some of these scriptures, especially the verses I'm going to read today, Genesis chapter 6, verses 1 through 4, there is a lot of confusion, and some of these newer versions don't help. I read through a few of them in those first four verses, and you're getting a whole bunch of different rhetoric because of translation. And I'm not talking about transliteration. I'm talking about taking words and changing words, sentence structure and everything to cater to a modern and more modern society. This is changing the Father's word. And I'm telling you, it's confusing people, and it leads more people astray because they start believing in more fanatical tales that just simply aren't true. You don't have the referencing ability within the scriptures itself because they keep changing the structure of the words, the sentencing, and everything else. Now, yes, no scripture is perfect, but I'm telling you, if you get a early version King James Bible, besides some of the words that are used, we all know that the names aren't the true names such as God. We know His name is Yahweh. Things like that, that's okay, that's something else to be learned. But when you start just outright changing sentence structure and putting different words in, people lose their ability to reference based on the scripture they're reading to other parts of the Bible itself, which defines itself. The Heavenly Father's word defines itself. Anyway, with that being said, let me get started. So hopefully someone will gain a better ability to be able to understand what the word is talking about without listening to so much of what other people say. Okay, first of all, let's spend a minute or so talking about angels. Angels are asexual beings. They do not procreate. They were created by the Heavenly Father. Angels can appear in the form of man. Angels have masculine names, so therefore there are no female angels. They are of a masculine form. Remember, the Father's in the business of creating things in His image, which obviously is a masculine form. He created Adam, and then He created Eve, the female form, from Adam. So that's just a little bit of what I'm going to say about angels. Angels do not procreate. Okay, now pay attention to some of the added detail that you're going to be getting from what I'm reading out of the 1870 Spirit of Prophecy. And now God says to His Son, "Let us make man in our image. As Adam came forth from the hand of his creator, he was of noble height and of beautiful symmetry. He was more than twice as tall as men now living upon the earth, and was well proportioned. His features were perfect and beautiful. His complexion was neither white nor sallow, but ruddy, glowing with the rich tint of health. Eve was not quite as tall as Adam. Her head reached a little above his shoulders. She too was noble, perfect in symmetry, and very beautiful. Now, this goes back to the notion of giants before I even get there. Understand, in early creation, everything was larger than it is now. You can go on the internet now and you can find pictures of giant skeletons and all these things. I'm sure some of them are fake. But the simple fact of the matter is that around this planet, throughout time, bones of giant humans have been found all over the place. All of this goes back to the flood. The Father destroyed this planet and preserved things within mountains and rocks in the ground and all these things as evidence of his power and things he had created. So there is legitimacy in a lot of these things that have been found around the planet. It wasn't for man and science to create all these stories about. It was as evidence of the Father's creation and his power. Now, Adam and Eve, they were larger than we are today. And according to what I read, it says at least twice as tall as what men are today. Now, some people may dispute that and may not agree, but if you believe scripture, you can read right in scripture where it talks about Goliath. And according to measurements during that time period, what they were, Goliath was between 10 to 12 feet tall himself. So what's the problem with believing that Adam and Eve, who were the first created, were not any larger or even larger than Goliath himself? The race of the Philistines had giant people. Remember when Moses and the Israelites wandered the desert? He sent them out to investigate the land of Canaan, and they came Canaan, and they came back with a report about the giants, a large race of people. If you look at individuals like Shaquille O'Neal, we even have an individual here in Virginia, his name is George Bell, who's a sheriff. He's nearly 8 feet tall. These people are looked upon as giants. You look at someone today that's seven something, nearly 8 feet tall, you say, wow, that individual's a giant. So the term giant has always been used to exaggerate the size of someone. But some individuals are truly giant in the eye of people looking up to them. So don't be so dismayed and in such possible disbelief that man hasn't been or wasn't 10, 12, or 13 feet tall. Anyway, so keep that in mind. Now, remember what I said about angels and about what I just read here about Adam and Eve and people being of great stature. Remember, scripture talks about the stature of people from time to time. Man's stature and everything else has been deteriorating. We don't even live as long as we did back then. Remember Methuselah, he lived to be 900 some odd years old. Adam, all these individuals lived to be hundreds of years old. So what's the difference between that and being bigger now? They were bigger, they lived longer, and now we're living a measly 100-120 years, if we can get that far. Most people are dying before they reach 60 because they don't take care of themselves. Anyway, so now let's move on. Okay, now let's start with Genesis chapter 6, verse 1. And it came to pass, when men began to multiply on the face of the earth, and daughters were born unto them. Let's stop right there. It's very simple and very clear. It says, when men began to multiply on the face of the earth, and daughters were born unto them. If you go to Genesis 1:28, it speaks upon Adam and Eve. The Father told them to be fruitful and multiply. And the reference to daughters being born into them is just a clear reminder that also daughters were born. Remember, Scripture speaks a lot about the lineages of the men, and everywhere you turn, it's about men. So it's just telling us that not only men were born during this time period, but women were being born unto them. Daughters were being born unto them. Just like today, sons and daughters are being born unto couples. Nothing more, nothing less. excuse me, verse 2 says that the sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were fair, and they took them wives of all which they chose. Now this is a part which is causing a lot of controversy and confusion. But let's break it down. It says that the sons of God, let's stop right there. The sons of God, by some, are being misled with the understanding that this is referring to angels because of the fall of Satan and the legions of angels that fell with him. So they're presuming that the sons of God, because it's referenced that way, are referring to angels. And reading through the rest of the scripture, their understanding or their thinking is that these angels fell down to the earth and saw that these women were fair, which in scriptural terms mean they were beautiful, and that they desired them and started to procreate with them. They took whom they wanted and procreated with them, took them as wives. And that's simply not true. It's a fairy tale. Remember what I told you about angels at the beginning. Now, let's break it down a little more. It says that the sons of God, well, who were these sons of God if they weren't angels? Well, listen to this. Back to the 1870, the spirit of prophecy. Seth was of more noble stature than Cain or Abel, and resembled Adam more than any of his sons. The descendants of Seth had separated themselves from the wicked descendants of Cain. Now, remember what I just told you about giants also. And it made note here that Seth was of more noble stature. Remember, these were they were of noble stature and prominence in their time. It says that the descendants of Seth had separated themselves from the wicked descendants of Cain. Once again, scripture, as well as the 1870 here, is separating the two classes of people. These were the two classes. The side of Cain, his descendants, were the wicked. Remember, the wicked, based on what Cain was all about, they refused the Heavenly Father. They were disobedient. They were prone to violence and all these types of things. And the descendants of Abel, and now Seth, because Cain slew Abel, are descendants of the righteous line. Now, what happened was the sons of God, whom were the descendants of Seth and Abel. Let's go back a couple of pages in Genesis, chapter 4, verse 26. And it reads, it says, "And to Seth, to him also there was born a son, and he called his name Enos. Then men began to call upon the name of the Lord." See, the line of Abel and now Seth, they still revered and were obedient and loved the Father. These were the sons of God, his righteous ones. That's simply all it's talking about. It is not referring to angels. The righteous were the sons of God, and Cain, they were the sons of men, men of the wicked. Simple. It's not as complicated and as fantastical as people are trying to make it. So, with that clarity, let's move on. Verse 3. It says, "And the Lord said, My spirit shall not always strive with man, for that he is also, for he also is flesh, yet his days shall be 120 years. The word says 120 years. Remember, they were living hundreds of years. The Father said he was not going to always strive with man. In fact, let me just cut their lifespan at a maximum of 120 years. So, if you see in the news these stories where people are saying so-and-so is 135 years old, this, that, and the other, the first thing they say about documentation is that, well, they weren't keeping records then, or they don't have any birth certificate, but because this person remembers something or have said something about... Look, let me tell you about this. The enemy can put all sorts of information in our heads. There are people who believe in reincarnation because the enemy has put historical information in children's heads, adults' heads, about others' previous life. That is work of the enemy. The Father wouldn't do that to any of us. That's all work of the enemy. Remember, he's full of deception and tricks. So anyway, moving on. Verse 4 says, "There were giants in the earth in those days." Getting back to people saying that those giants were angels. They were the people of noble stature. That line of Cain that was already here. Listen to the scripture in the order that it's written and understand that this was before the angels or before all these other things. It says, there were giants in the earth in those days, and also after that, when the sons of God, remember who I said they were, the line of Seth, when the sons of God came in unto the daughters of men, when the righteous sons of Seth, his lineage, saw that the women of Cain's lineage were beautiful, they started mixing with them and creating another race of people. Righteous mixed with the wicked. And they bare children to them. The same became mighty men, which were of old, men of renown. Simply all is saying that the righteous line of Seth saw that these women of the unrighteous were beautiful, and they started mixing with them. This had nothing to do with angels. Let me read this part here. And it reads here. It says, but when men multiplied upon the earth, the descendants of Seth saw that the daughters of the descendants of Cain were very beautiful. When the righteous saw that the wicked women were beautiful, and it continues, and they departed from God and displeased him by taking wives as they chose of the idolatrous race of Cain. Now, isn't that interesting? As far as I'm concerned, before I found it in the 1870, I already understood what scripture was saying when it said the sons of God. Oh, it's talking about the righteous. The daughters of men or the sons of men. Oh, it's talking about wicked. Remember, we're always talking about two classes. And no matter how they phrase it, it's talking about two classes. This has nothing to do with angels. So let me read these four scriptures all over again so that you can get it in its full context. And based on what I've explained, what it really means. Chapter 6, it reads, and it came to pass, when men began to multiply on the face of the earth, and daughters were born unto them, the sons of God saw that the daughters of men, that they were fair, and they took them wives of all which they chose. And the Lord said, my spirit shall not always strive with man, for that he is also flesh, yet his days shall be 120 years. There were giants in the earth in those days, and also after that, when the sons of God came in unto the daughters of men, and they bare children to them, the same became mighty men, which were of old, men of renown. This displeased the father. This disrupted all sorts of things. And he said, you know what? He said, my spirit's not always going to strive with man, because they're nothing but flesh. Even these righteous men of the line of Seth can't even contain themselves from the wicked women of Canaan or Cain, because they're beautiful. They let the flesh take over, and they, some of them departed from the Father. And this is all it's explaining. There were giants. They were already here. This had nothing to do with the angels. The statue of man back in the time of Adam and Eve and in early history was much larger than we are today, and we've deteriorated to the puny little 5 foot whatever people we are today. But like I always say, scripture is not as complicated as it appears, and it's not as simple as some make it out to be. But if you study, you will get that discernment. You will get the guidance from the set apart spirit himself to understand the word. So with that being said, remember, the Heavenly Father does not call on us to be successful. He calls on us to be obedient, faithful, and loving to one another, and loving him with all our heart, our mind, and our soul. This is 2B7. I'm out.